They call him the Iceman, Jerry Butler. But why is this singer called the Iceman? Why does he talk to me about the Battle of the Baritones? And what does it take to become successful as a singer? Let's take you back to 1982. I'm live in the studio of WSSJ in Camden, New Jersey. That's right across the river from Philadelphia.
Whoa, Western Union man, send a telegram.
1310 WSSJ, and we have in our studios this afternoon a very, very special guest, Jerry Butler, the Iceman. How you doing?
I'm doing fine, Jerry.
What brings you into the Philadelphia area?
We are appearing over at the Mann Music Center tonight with Barry White and Harold Melvin, and we expect that it's going to be an interesting show. It's the first time I've ever worked with three baritone singers. You know, I mean, that's going to be kind of unique.
I think it will be a fantastic show because it's a dynamite combination. How can it miss?
Well, I don't really know. I usually think in terms of contrast in styles, and this may sound a little self-serving, but you know, I think that Isaac Hayes was kind of coming from where I was coming from, and I think that Barry White kind of came from where Isaac Hayes was coming from, and I think, in a sense, Harold Melvin was coming from that same place. So it's really kind of an extension. And it's going to be interesting to see how this comes off. I'm really dying to do it so I can see.
I wish you good luck with the show. I know that you'll knock them dead.
Well, they tell me it's sold out, so I guess there are a lot of people interested in seeing how it's going to go.
You've embarked on something which is, I would say it's unique, and that is Fountain Records. You're the owner of the company, I understand, and this is something that you formed back in 1980, I believe, when you were still with Philly International.
Right.
What's it like to be an owner of a record company?
It's very difficult. It's difficult for two reasons. One is to be an artist is a total kind of experience. Then to step out of that and to try and be a record company owner becomes another kind of experience. And the only reason that I was willing to try this is because over the 23 years, the experience that I've gathered from being both an artist and involved in production and having some distributorship knowledge, I decided to get into it. But the real key was the young people that I've surrounded myself with. Wes Phillips here, who is an economics major and who has been a salesman and who's been a promotion person, is really the guys that run the company. The buck stops at my desk. I make all of the final decisions, but I give an open door policy to them where they bring to me and then we try to implement their ideas. Our first album was on a group out of the Midwest called Omni. It was called Omni Says It All. They're a self-contained group and we did very well in the Midwestern region with them. But because of our financial structure, we did not want to try it on a national level. Then after leaving PIR, I decided that if I was good enough to do it, I should be willing to stake my career on what I believed in. And so because of that, I decided to release the forthcoming album on Fountain Records. It'll be called Ice and Hot, and you already have the first single from it.
Where does the nickname the Iceman come from, and how did you pick that up?
George Wood started that as a joke of about 1960 or so. He and I used to do a bunch of shows over at the Uptown Theater, and in those days, all of the performers had nicknames. James Brown was Mr. Dynamite, Jackie Wilson was Mr. Excitement, Roy Hamilton was Mr. Golden Throat, Jesse Belvin was Mr. Easy, and he said, we got to get you a nickname. So he started out calling me Cool, and then one day he came up with the Iceman, and because he was a communicator and on the air, people passing through the area picked it up, the press got a hold to it, and then about late 1960s, 67, 68, Kenny Gamble, Leon Huff, and I collaborated on an album called The Iceman Cometh. And that really kind of locked it in because the album was so big and got exposed in so many places that everybody just started to use it.
That was one of my favorite Jerry Butler albums of the past.
Thank you.
Nowadays, it seems to be in vogue that a lot of male artists are teaming up with females and vice versa. We have a lot of duets.
Yes. I have gone back probably to the early 60s with a girl by the name of Betty Everett.
Let it be me.
We had a song called Let It Be Me, which was a very big, and an album entitled Delicious Together. And then about 1971, I had a songwriter's workshop in Chicago, which is how I met Brenda Lee Ager.
Understanding me. Understanding me.
we did Ain't Understanding Mellow and Close to You and several tunes like that. But just before leaving PIR, I did a song called Don't Be an Island with a young lady from Group Silk. Her name is Deborah Henry, and she is working with me tonight over at the Mann Music Center. We expect that if all things go well for Fountain, that the next album will be an album of duets with she and I, and probably following that, an album on Deborah Henry by herself. I think she's a fantastic singer, and as folks will attest to that have seen her, she is a fired-up lady.
Jerry Butler on WSSJ, and Jerry, you've been a performing artist, you've been a writer, you've been involved with television commercials, you've won Grammy Awards, Clio Awards for the commercials. Now you own your own record company. It seems you've been involved in every facet of the music industry. What is your favorite part?
Performing is always an instant gratification. I mean, it does not take you 6 months to find out whether you did good or you did bad. It is an instant on. Every song tells you, well, this song was great, this song was nice, this song was you know, and you know right away before the show is over whether you did good or bad. When you are in the production capability, it may take you 6 months to finish it. It may take you another 3 or 4 months to find out whether or not people really liked what you spent all of that time doing. When you get to the record company owner situation, it becomes more extended because now it may take us 2 or 3 years to find out whether or not we're going to be a successful record company. So all of the things have a different high for you. It just depends on which one you like best. I really opt for the performance because that is the closest relationship that I ever have with the people. And usually they are very honest and tell you exactly whether you're on base or not. And it is one of the reasons why I decided to do the record company thing. I felt that after 23 years of doing this and the people still applauding and saying, yeah, Jerry, we love you, that I should maybe take some of that experience and knowledge and pass it on to some younger folks.
You've been involved in the music business for 23 years. If you weren't into music, what do you think you might otherwise have gotten into?
I would probably be cooking someplace. I studied culinary arts in school, and I was going to be a chef and had planned to go to Michigan State to take some business management courses. I was going to be a restaurateur. And just about the time that I graduated high school, I formed The Impressions, and we recorded For Your Precious Love. And 3 weeks later, it was all over the country, and folks were buying it, and I was in show business. So then I had to reevaluate what I was going to do and get deeply into the show business aspect of it. But I still do a lot of cooking around home, and I think probably when it comes time for Jerry Butler to hang up the microphones and all that kind of stuff, I still may open up that restaurant just to see if I cook as good for other folks as I think I do for myself.
What's your favorite dish?
I have no particular favorite dish. Because of the European culture and the background of the culinary arts school, we do everything from crepe Suzettes to chitlins, you see. And because of my growing up in a soulful house, I know that aspect of it too. And I think probably when and if I do ever open up this restaurant, it'll be really a fun kind of place to come and eat because we'll have a bunch of everything in there for you.
I hope we at SSJ get invited to the opening. I'm sure we'll partake.
I'll try. That's a good idea. That's a good idea. If you plan to like spend whatever it costs to come, probably by that time it'll cost you $2,000 to fly from Camden, New Jersey to Chicago.
Well, I don't know if I'll be able to get into it then, but let's put our fingers crossed. One more thing I'd like to ask you before we listen to your latest release, for the benefit of some of the young and struggling musicians possibly that are listening or vocalists that want to get involved in the music business, how long was it between when you first started singing professionally and that first hit song? How long a road was that for you?
I'm not a good person to ask that question. And the reason for it is that my very first song was a hit. The very first song that we ever recorded was For Your Precious Love. And it has become synonymous with not only myself, but with The Impressions. It was rare in the sense that it happened that way. After For Your Precious Love, though, it took me about 3 or 4 years before I had another hit. And so I think that most of the young people should understand that what happened to me was miracle kind of stuff. And I think James Brown and some of the other artists who came along in the same period will attest to that. Also, the industry was different at that point in time. If you had a good song, jocks could play it two or three times on the same show, you know, and say, oh, I like this so nice, I'm going to play it twice, you know, and that doesn't happen now because of the format structure and all of the other things.
So the good old days when you could play your tambourine along with the song.
Oh, yeah, you know, and jump up and down and holler and hoop and, you know, do all kinds of stuff.
Sometimes I wish I could do that, too.
Well, you know, maybe some take one day and do you a little special thing. Say, this is old-time radio.
Searching for it,
I don't think Gary Shepherd, our program director,
well,
would like that.
You know, Gary Shepherd probably won't like it. But if you get good ratings, he'll like it a whole lot better. And if you get enough sponsors for it, he'll love it.
All right, Jerry. On that note, we'd like to thank you for stopping into WSSJ. Wish you success tonight at the Mann Music Center, along with Harold Melvin and the Blue Notes and Barry White.
Yes.
Again, good success to you, and thank you for stopping by. We'll close out. This is Jerry's latest song on Fountain Records.